Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Lord's house this morning. Today we get to gather to worship our God. Throughout the week we get to gather together and work in God's kingdom. I just want to highlight a few announcements before we get to worship today about the work that's going on here at our congregation. One thing that's on our minds and coming up here in September is our annual garage sale. And you can find an announcement about that on the green sheet. But just to highlight a couple of things, items are needed, and then also there's a sign-up sheet in the back for workers, so please check those things out. A couple of exciting things coming up in our congregation as well, in our gospel ministry. Coming up September 13th, we're calling that Fresh Start Sunday, and our goal is to reach out to our St. John's members and get as many people into worship as we possibly can. Perhaps you've already received a postcard. If you haven't, it'll be coming very soon. And then also we're going to just personally invite and follow up on that postcard. So if you would like to help us make friendly phone calls just to say, hey, did you get a postcard? We'd like to have you on September 13th, real quick and short and friendly. If you'd like to help us out with that calling, please see me and we'll get you signed up and let you know what work is available for that. Also, along with that, on that day we'll be starting a special sermon series on a life of growth in God's Word. And to help out with that, you'll see all around church today some business card-sized invitations. They just have some quick information. It has the themes of the sermon series. These are designed to be quick, simple, easy ways for you to just invite someone to hear the message of God's Word. It has the dates and the themes on there. So they're all over the tables in the back. They're back by your mailboxes. Pick one up and just share it with somebody. Also, another, I think, an exciting thing is on your way out today, you'll receive what we're calling a fall catalog of ministries. We have all the ministries from worship, education, fellowship, service, all the things that are going on from now through November, so through the fall here. Those are all listed and explained. All the dates and times are there for you. You'll get that as you get that resource as you leave today. So make sure you get a fall catalog of ministries for yourself. Now as we gather for worship today, we're going to continue and it will be our final Sunday of our sermon series on the popular parables of Jesus. And today, we're going to look at the parable of the hidden treasure and the pearl of great price. What we're going to see today from God's Word is what truly is wealth, what truly is treasure. If you've come here today looking for something great, looking for that treasure, you found it. You found it in the Word of God. And may He bless you richly as you experience that treasure today. As we prepare our hearts for worship, please just take a moment to greet each other and get to know each other as we worship our God today. God's blessings. Thank you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children. But we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from her birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you, and did not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me, according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, He has removed your guilt forever. You are His own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Almighty and everlasting God, give us an increase of faith, hope, and love, and that we may obtain what you promise, make us love what you command. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. We now focus our hearts and our minds on the lessons from God's Word. In our first lesson, we see a contrast. The contrast of attitudes about wealth, what wealth really is. For those who know the Lord and what He promises in His Word, there is where they find wealth, in God's promises, in His love. The world seeks after things that are not wealth, things that are fleeting. And so we see that the true wealth truly is God's word. A lesson from Psalm 1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
In our second lesson, I want you to notice the Apostle Paul's attitude toward God and his word. Certainly, every earthly blessing that he has, that we have, is exactly that, a blessing from God. But then when you compare it to the eternal riches that come through Jesus, that come through the gospel of the word of God, all of those other things are worthless. Jesus is worth everything. A reading from Philippians chapter 3. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord. Alleluia. Jesus Christ has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Alleluia. The gospel records the words and works of our Savior. Please stand in respect. The gospel will serve as the sermon text this morning, so we will explain it further at that time. The gospel according to Matthew chapter 13. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things? Jesus asked. Yes, they replied. He said to them, therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Now at this time, invite the children of the congregation to come forward for a children's sermon.
Hey, Travis. Just you and me today, huh? Want to sit up right here? I can sit right in the front row, and we can have kind of a collective children's sermon together today. All right. Got a question for you. Sometimes, the way things look on the outside doesn't give a good... example of what it's really worth. For example, I got a wad of money right here and I got a crumpled piece of paper. Which one do you want? Probably, yeah, I would choose that one too, right? But would it be interesting if I open this piece of paper and say there's $5 here, that's nice to have $5, but in this crumpled piece of paper it says, I, John Zimpelman, promise to give Travis $100. Now which one do you want? Right, yeah, very good. Sometimes what you see on the outside doesn't really show what it's really worth, right? That's kind of what Jesus was sharing with us today when Pastor Teal just read from the Gospel of Matthew. As you get older, maybe, as right now too, think about the things in life, whether at school or at home or at work or whatever it may be, that seemingly look to hold a lot of value, seem to have a lot of worth, whether it's your toys or your friends or money, or as you get older, a job or your retirement fund, whatever it is over here in this hand, right, with the money. And God says, over here is this book. I'm just kind of fraying over here. It's got a rubber band to keep it together. And if we held them over here like this, like in a scale, I think the rest of the world would say, wow, this one's worth way more. All your money and all your friends and all your family and all your toys and everything that you have far outweighs this book, right? Until you open it up and you see what's in this book. And you and I know that the greatest treasure in the world, worth more than anything else out there, is what God put in this book. What do we know in the Bible? What does the Bible tell us? It says Jesus died on the cross to take away all our sins. That's the greatest treasure that you have and that you have. Because one day, we're all going to stand before God, as Jesus said, and God's going to be able to look at you and look at me and say, you know, why should I let you into heaven, Travis? Why should I let you into heaven? And I might be able to say, well, look, God, look at all the things I did on earth. I got all this money. I worked so hard, and I piled up all this money. I'll give it all to you if I can come into heaven. And God will say, that's very good, but that won't get you into heaven. But God, look at all the good things I did on earth, the kind things I did, the nice words I said. I went to church, went to Sunday school. I came to the children's devotions when no one else was there. I give all those things to you, God. And God will say, those are all good things, but none of those things will get you into heaven. And we look down and say, I don't have anything left to give. And that's when God smiles and says, that's right. It's not what you give me. It's what I gave you. And what you always had that whole time in that book, in your heart, was that message that Jesus died for your sins on that cross. And God says, you have that treasure, then you get to have my eternal treasure. You get to come into heaven with me because you have the greatest treasure. Wow, and all of you have that. And to think about right now, as you hold in your heart what's most important, it is very tempting to say, yeah, my toys, my money, my friends, everything that's so important, I can put this treasure and leave it over here. And God would say today, please hold on to the most important treasure, because when you have this, you have everything else. And when you have this, God's holding on to you too. Can you join me in a prayer? We'll say thank you to God for his greatest treasure. Dear Savior, we are sometimes confused about what's really worth life. Please forgive us for putting too much worth and too much value on your earthly blessings. Help us to make your word and your son Jesus our greatest treasure. Thank you for that gift. Amen. Thanks for coming up today. And we worship God as we sing our next hymn together. the name of Jesus Christ, who is your greatest treasure. The word of God that we'd like to look at today are those parables from Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew. If you turn there in your worship folder, we'll take a look at each of those individually and see what great treasure Jesus has hidden in his word for us today. Dear people of God, are you feeling rich these days? It's kind of hard to feel rich when things like the stock market act like a roller coaster at Valley Fair. Slowly climbing, tick, 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 and then last week, whoosh, right? And it takes a big bite out of your retirement savings in about 10 seconds. It's kind of hard to feel rich when your car always needs work, your furnace is going to be replaced this winter, the doctor's visits keep on coming, the kids need more school supplies and clothes, endless supplies. It's hard to feel rich, but the truth is you are. You are rich. And I might be wrong about this, but none of us had to roll out from underneath a pile of newspapers to come to church this morning because we couldn't afford a roof over our head anymore or because we had no bed to sleep on. And as tight as things may get at times, and as much as we worry about our finances, as far as I know, none of us came to church wearing the only pair of clothes that we have. Or truly wondering where we're going to get our next meal today. It might not feel like it. And it might not seem like it all the time. And it might not look like it. But if you ask any other person in the world to take a look at your life, there's really no other way for them to describe it than this. You are rich. But that's just scraping the surface of how rich you really are. Today, God would have us peel back all those beautiful earthly blessings that we do thank him for and really look at the storehouse and the vast treasures that he has given to you. When God brought you to faith through baptism and through his holy word, he made you rich. When he gave you his own son, Jesus, to take away your sin, he made you rich. Giving you peace in your heart and purpose in your life and hope for a future in heaven. And God gave all of the treasures of the kingdom of heaven. He gave them all to you so that you truly are rich. So what are you going to do with those treasures? Are you going to make them the joy of your life? Or will you fail to see the value in your real worth and let those treasures slip right out of your fingers? Jesus tells us three stories again today to put those questions right before our eyes. And they're stories about a treasure hidden in a field and about a pearls that are very valuable and about a net full of fish. But they're all stories about our hearts. And they're stories about God's treasures. And so we listen again to Jesus' parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had, and he bought that field. They say fortunes are made and lost in a matter of moments and seconds today, right? And we saw that again this past week with the stock market. I wonder how different things were back then in Jesus' time in the ancient world. When fortunes could be made and even lost in a second, but in a totally different way, right? Not in the stock market, but when a band of roaming thieves would come through and just pick out your property to completely steal. And it's all gone, everything you have. Or war would ravage an entire land and the spoils of the war would be everything you own. They take it all away. Or a natural disaster like fire would come and just consume your life's worth. And they didn't have insurance back then. The FDIC wasn't there to ensure at least a return on things lost, right? But the thing they did have, back then the ancients always had a plan. And historians said that the ancients typically would take all of their wealth and they divide it into thirds. And the first third they'd use kind of like working capital. Sell property, buy property, run your business. The second portion of their wealth they would kind of liquidate or convert into gems and precious stones so that they could take it in the fold of their coat. If they had to leave quickly, they could go and start a new life somewhere with wealth. But that final third of their wealth, their fortune, was a most important part. And they'd take that part of their wealth and they would hide it. Somewhere secret, somewhere safe. They'd bury it in the ground because if they had to go quickly, they could come back and dig up their treasure. But the thing is about buried treasure is sometimes it stayed buried. If someone would bury it and then go off and they die, someone forgot where they put it, that wealth would lay in the ground, hidden somewhere, until someone else came across that treasure and found it and made a fortune. And that's exactly what Jesus is talking about with that man in our first parable, is walking through a field, not really looking for anything, and he stumbles across this treasure, and he sells everything he has to buy up the field, and therefore gain the treasure for himself. And Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is just like that. And while his disciples are scratching their heads and trying to figure out exactly what Jesus meant, he went on to tell another parable. Jesus said, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had, and he bought it. So again, for us to understand really the point of that parable, we have to understand the difference between back then and now. Pearls back then, way different than pearls today. Today you can go down to the local jewelry shop and buy a string of pearls, and it's not cheap. But back then, the only way you came across pearls, today we can harvest them, manufacture them, and grow them. Back then, the only people who could hold their breath and dive down and actually find them would have these pearls. And they were the most valuable treasure. And in fact, there's one recorded incident in history where a Roman general named Vitellius actually funded an entire Roman military campaign, a whole war, with one of his mother's pearl earrings. How much money would that be today? Hundreds of millions of dollars, maybe. Isn't that put a whole new meaning on when in Revelation, Jesus describes the gates of heaven being carved out of one pearl? Wow, think of the glory that Jesus is saying is waiting for us there, the treasure of heaven. But maybe to help illustrate it more is if we compared pearls back then to the way we look at diamonds today. Maybe if Jesus told the parable today, he'd say it like this. There was a diamond importer going around, and he was buying up precious diamonds when he could find them. And when he came across one that was so unbelievably better than all the rest, like the crown jewel, he sold everything he ever found in life. Every other diamond he bought up around the world, he was ready to sell it just to have that one precious diamond. And Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is just like that. It's just like a man wandering through a field, not really looking for anything, and stumbling upon the greatest treasure. It's just like a man knowing exactly what he's looking for and searching intently for it and finding something far greater. The kingdom of heaven is just like that. And those two people, that's you and me. And so how'd that happen for you? How did you come upon the world's greatest treasure? Maybe someone brought you to this baptismal font right here, and God made you the richest person in the world. Or maybe you were stumbling through life, not really looking for anything valuable, and someone invited you to church, or someone shared Jesus with you. Or maybe you were looking for something of value and meaning, trying to find it in politics, or morals, or other things in life, and then the message of Jesus was shared with you. However you came across the greatest treasure, however God gave it to you, you are in possession of the world's greatest fortune. The message that a Savior came down from heaven just for you. It is a message like no other. It is a treasure like no other. Because look at what an unlikely place that treasure is found. The world's greatest treasure can be found inside of a sentence. Isn't that amazing? In a song that you just sang. In something children can talk about. Who in the world out there would think that the world's greatest fortune could be found in a sentence? And yet it's the one message that can save a person forever. It's the one message that can give you purpose and guidance in your life. It's the one message that gives you hope for where things are going to turn out after you die. And God went and took all of that treasure and he went and put it right in your heart. But he didn't just put it in your heart. God says he puts it in your hands too. Because it's not just a treasure worth seeking, it's a treasure worth sharing as well. Jesus told one more parable. He said, once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into a lake and caught all kinds of fish. When the net was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. And then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad fish away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus, your Savior, says a day is coming when everyone's going to have to face God, everyone. And whether you're standing in the robes of Jesus Christ or in your own filthy rags of sin, everyone's going to face God. That net is going to catch everybody. That's why Jesus says, I can't be second place in your life. Did you notice the way that Jesus ended both those parables? The guy goes home, sells everything else he ever had to hold on to the one thing worth having. Jesus won't settle for second place in your life. He can't. What else in your life will allow you entrance into the kingdom of heaven, into God's eternal kingdom? Nothing else you have but Jesus. But Jesus says, when you have me, you have everything. I won't be second place to your schedule. I can't be second place to your family. I won't settle for second place to your retirement plans or your lusts or your emotions or anything else that you hold of value in life. Because when you have me, you have everything, Jesus says. When God gave you Jesus, he gave you your greatest treasure. He gave you the robes of perfection that we sang about. When Jesus was here on earth and he lived perfectly, God wrapped you up in that when he gave you Jesus. When God gave you Jesus, he immediately washed away every one of your failures and sins and mistakes. When God gave you Jesus, he gave you rest in your restless soul. Like a key fitting into a lock, you have peace there that nothing else in the world can give you. And if God loves you that much, he says, I'm going to take every single moment of your life, every single second, and promise to work it out to that eternal end that you receive that treasure. If God loves you that much, to love you and forgive you that much, and to be with you every step of the way, he also promises you at the end of your life, I promise my angels will be there at your last breath to carry you home, to live with me in my home forever. But that wasn't even enough for God to give to you. Because God knows you and me, and he knows that sometimes we're very quick to doubt God, and we're very slow to believe God's promises. He knows that it's hard. To feel like you have God's greatest treasure. It's hard to feel like you're a child of God when you fall into the same sins 3 or 4 times a week. And sometimes we want to scream, God, if you love me, maybe you'd make my life a little better. This is your treasure for me, this life? How dare you tell me that all things are working out for my good when it's my health and my family and my life that's suffering so much? And heaven? That seems so far away. I have all these things in my life, my plans and my struggles to worry about. You're talking about heaven? And what does God do? He gives you his word. So that you don't have to cling and chase after the meaningless purposes of mankind that are breath. They lead you nowhere. They're meaningless. But God gives you his promises right here. You can read them again and again, like a bank statement. You can open up and see how rich you really are. You can read again and again, God so loved the world, and that means God so loved me. But that wasn't enough for God either. He gave us holy baptism, and he gave us the Lord's Supper so that you could feel his grace washing over your head, and you could taste and see and touch that the Lord is good. But not just that the Lord is good, but that his love and mercy are just for you. And he promised his Holy Spirit would be bound like chains to that word and sacrament, so that whenever you read the word, whenever you receive his sacrament, there God is reminding you and strengthening you in what your greatest treasure truly is. God put that treasure in your heart. You are the richest person in the world right now. But he didn't just put it in your heart. He also now puts it in your hands. Because that treasure that he gave just to you and just to me, he also gave it to the entire world. He says it's for everybody. And so at the end of his parables, Jesus asks his disciples, you guys get this? Do you understand? And they say, yeah, we get it. And he says, good. Because every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. Jesus says, we've become disciples. We're those students of the kingdom of heaven. We have that wisdom now. He says, now God says, I give you that responsibility and I give you that privilege to go and share that with everybody. They all need to know that they have a treasure in Jesus Christ too, just like you do. And so what does that mean for you and me today? Does it mean every one of us has to go home today and go buy a stack of Bibles and walk around Hastings and go to our neighbors and say, here you go, here you go? No. We don't have to do that, but God is saying every one of us can live our lives in such a way, the things we say and the way we live, that when people look at us, they will be led to praise our Father in heaven and glorify him. Is Jesus saying we all have to go home today and buy one of those loudspeakers and mount it on top of the minivan and drive around Hastings and say, the kingdom of heaven is near, repent, judgment is coming? No. But every one of us can quietly have a conversation with somebody that we know and invite them to come and find the treasure of heaven that God has given to them too. Every one of us can do that. Is God saying we have to go home and liquidate everything we have and go be missionaries across the world? No. But thank God for those who do. And each one of us can work hard at our jobs and thank him for the blessings we receive from that, and then be willing and even eager to give our first fruit offerings back to the Lord. Not the bottom of the pot, but our first heart, our first gift, so that the gospel ministry, the treasure that God's given you, can continue to be spread here at St. John's and around the Hastings area and around the whole world. Each one of us here today can do those things, because each one of us here today has the treasure of the kingdom of heaven. Each one of us, God has placed that treasure in your heart and said, I love you. Here's my gift to you. About each one of us, it can be said today, and it couldn't be said any other way. You are rich. God grant that we hold on to our wealth and our riches as God holds on to us through his eternal and life-saving word. Amen. Please stand. May he who began this good work of faith in you now carry it on to completion until that great day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As Christians have been doing for hundreds of years, thousands even, we join in confessing our faith by proclaiming the wonderful things that God is and the things he's done for us in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We thank God with our offerings at this time.
Please stand for prayer. O Lord, light of the world, saving strength of your people, we thank you for the treasure of your word. Implant it in the hearts of your people so that, set free from the power of Satan and the fear of death, we may live to serve and honor you. Pour out your Spirit on us, that we may grow richly in divine knowledge and spiritual understanding. Bless the proclamation of your word everywhere, so that hearts may be turned from the darkness of spiritual ignorance, falsehood, and despair to the light of knowledge, truth, and life. Let your word shine in our homes, that parents and children may dwell together in love and serve one another in kindness and humility. Lord, watch over the sick, the sorrowing, the anxious, and the weary. Preserve those who are in any danger of body or soul. Supply us by the grace of Jesus with the Spirit's power that we may be ever comforted by your truth and sustained by your love. For these and all other things you know that we need, we confidently ask in the name of him who gave himself for us that we might live through him. In the name of Jesus, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for our closing hymn.